الحمد لله رب العالمين، صلى الله وسلم وبارك على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا. ثم أما بعد، إمام البخاري رحمه الله تعالى، إمام مسلم، they narrated the story of Umran Hussein رضي الله تعالى عنه, the companion of the Prophet صلوات الله وسلامه عليه. He mentioned the story that one day in a gathering that Umran Hussein was sitting, they spoke about a shooting star that appeared in the sky the night before. So he said, من رأى منكم الكوكب البارحة؟ Who amongst you have seen this kokab, which means that shooting star that actually appeared in the night? You know, people, they see these wonders in the sky, which is unfortunately we don't see these days because of the kind of light pollution that we see in these cities, in urban areas. But they lived this natural life so they could see these beautiful things. So when he mentioned that, some of them, they said, yes, I did see that. And then in order just to perhaps prevent any kind of misconception, or maybe that's trying to show up, he says, أَمَا إِنِّي لَمْ أَكُنْ I did not wake up for قيام الليل. I wasn't doing قيام الليل. Just to let you know, I saw it, but I wasn't doing قيام الليل. So he asked him, so why, what exactly were you doing? He goes, I was bitten by some insect, and I just woke up because of that. I was trying to treat that pain. And he asked him, what exactly did you do? He said, I did so and so. He said, well, if you said so, let me teach you something what the Prophet ﷺ told us to do. And Rasulullah ﷺ says, يَدْخُلُ مِنْ أُمَّتِي سَبْعُونَ أَلْ يَدْخُلُ مِنْ أُمَّتِي الْجَنَّةِ سَبْعُونَ أَلْفًا بِغَيْرِ حِسَابٍ وَالْعَدَادِ The Prophet ﷺ, he said in the hadith, that 70,000 people from my ummah, from my generation, from my ummah, Muhammad ﷺ, will enter paradise without any account, without any reckoning. And then he left them. So when the Prophet ﷺ walked out, the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhum, they sat together and they sat now arguing or discussing who could those be people? Who could they be? 70,000 people. Some of them, they said, those who will be born in Islam. The first people ever born in Islam did not associate any partners of worship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in their lives. Others, they said, no, these are the people who will come at later generation. So they start speculating who could those people be. When the Prophet ﷺ came out, and they asked him, Ya Rasulullah, could you please elaborate? Tell us who those people could be, 70,000 people. He gave four qualities. He said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, هُمُ الَّذِينَ لَا يَسْتَرْقُونَ Those who don't seek ruqya, means don't seek from people to do ruqya for them. Recitation of the Quran over their pain and their body. That's number one. الَّذِينَ لَا يَكْتَرُونَ Those who don't use al-kay, which means fire, in their kind of treatment, cauterization. Number three, وَلَا يَتَطَيَّرُونَ And they don't believe in superstition at all. وَعَلَىٰ رَبِّهِمْ يَتَوَكَّلُونَ And those who rely on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala fully. All the time they rely on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he finished that statement. If you were in that gathering, what would you do? Perhaps while you're sitting there, you would wish that you would be one of them, right? How many of you would wish to be among the 70,000 people? Raise your hands if you wish to be among the 70,000 people. Okay, so all of you wish to be among them. Eh? You don't want to go to Al-Jannah without Hisab, so you just want to go straight to Al-Jannah. But what would you do to get there? Many of us, which I think are now making a plan. I'm going to try, inshallah, my best to be one of these people. I'm going to start making a specific plan to get there and so on. But there was one Sahabi. He was one companion who took an initiative that was not taken by anyone before him. He came first and he said, Ya Rasulullah, ud'u Allah an akuna minhum. Make dua for Allah that I will be one of them. He just took that initiative, an opportunity. It was just like a chance for him. Said, Ya Rasulullah, can you make dua for Allah to make me one of the 70,000? The Prophet ﷺ says, anta minhum. You got it. Means you are one of those 70,000 people. Subhanallah, such an amazing opportunity. This man, radiallahu ta'ala anhu Allah, came first. And then, after he started it, guess how many people would wish to do that? Everybody will come after him. So another man, he said, Ya Rasulullah, how about me? The Prophet ﷺ says, سَبَقَكَ بِهَا عُكَاشَ عُكَاشَ took it first. Which means عُكَاشَ came first. That's it, I close the door over there. How many of us have seen opportunities, chances come in their lives, legitimate chances, good chances, mashallah, career chances, marriage chances, education, ibadah and worship, many, many chances would come your way, but because you did not really take an action, you just went away. And you were unable to retrieve that chance or opportunity after that. And you will always regret that opportunity. Ukasha radiallahu ta'ala, he said that word, and in the Arabic language, the exact word itself, which is sabaqaka biha Ukasha, became an Arab proverb. If someone now among the Arab community tries to say something after being second, they always tell him, sabaqaka biha Ukasha. Ukasha came first, which means if you come second, if you don't come first, then you lost your opportunities. You know, my dear brothers and sisters, opportunities are one of two. There are opportunities, which basically you have missed. One, you have missed, and the other one, you don't really want to miss. Those are the two opportunities that exist in life. The one you already have is no longer an opportunity, it's reality. So therefore, you need to be active as much as possible to increase your level of reaching these opportunities. Every time there's a new challenge that you need to seek and look up to and find and pursue it. Now the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhum wa ardahum, they have played this great actually example for us. They have shown the example of seeking these opportunities, trying always to come first radiallahu ta'ala anhum wa ardahum. It's part of our deen, always to seek these opportunities, always to come first. And I've just mentioned that actually in fundraisings, people when they go and they try to give charity and so on, they set great examples. But it's always the one who comes first who takes the reward for everybody else, as the Prophet ﷺ said. مَنْ دَعَ إِلَى هُدَى كَانَ لَهُ أَجْرُهُ وَأَجْرُ مَنْ عَمِلَ بِهِ لِيَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ. One day the Prophet ﷺ, he calls the companions when he saw a delegation coming from Ghafar, poor, destitute, half actually dressed, half naked. So the Prophet ﷺ, tama'ara wajhu, his face changed out of sorrow and grief for the condition. So he gave a khutbah, and in that khutbah he called the community to fundraise for this community, for this small group of people. So the people, when they heard that, they immediately took the opportunity. One of them, he came carrying with him, was the first man to arrive. And he came carrying in his hand this huge bag of food, clothes and stuff and so on. And when the Prophet ﷺ saw that, the Sahaba describing it, عَجَزَتْ يَدَى, means his hand barely can carry it. And he puts it in front of the Prophet ﷺ. Others, when they saw that, start running and bringing their stuff. And then piles of food and clothes start emerging and appearing before the Prophet ﷺ, and he starts smiling. And then he gave the khutbah and he says, مَنْ دَعَ إِلَى هُدَى, whoever sets an example, meaning example of guidance, who calls people for guidance, كَانَ لَهُ أَجْرُهُ, he'll get the reward for that. وَأَجْرُ مَنْ عَمِلَ بِهِ, and anybody else who does that because of him, إِلَى يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ, until the day of judgment. Why? Because he came first. He was the first person to do that, and everybody will come actually after him. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, سَارِعُوا, سَارِعُوا إِلَى مَغْفِرُ, سَابِقُوا إِلَى جَنَّةِ. So Allah is asking us to rush and run and race towards Al-Jannah and to seek your forgiveness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah wants you to always come first. Because what's about race anyway, other than coming first? And if I ask you the question, and I'm sure that all of us had this opportunity when we were younger, I don't know about you guys living in the city, maybe you don't have an opportunity to get together very often, but living in a space where you have a lot of kids in one neighborhood, we always enjoy this kind of, the kind of games that we have to establish, you know, in the community. And one of these beautiful games we all had is race. We used to race. How many of you played that game when you were younger? Raise your hand. Come on, don't be shy. Boys and girls, perhaps boys, they love that more than the girls. Why? Because the boys, they love achievements. They love to come first. Sisters, they might, you know, run together. But the guys, they want to run to be first. Eventually, what is the best part of the race, ya jama'ah? Can you tell me, what is the best part of the race? Winning, coming first, right? And what is the worst part of the race? Can you tell me? Coming last, right? Wrong. Coming second. That's the worst part of the race. You know why? Because you were almost there. Barely there, and you missed it. And you start blaming yourself, if I just pushed one more, if I've done one more, if I've done more extra effort and put energy more and so forth, eventually the one who's in the back all the way lost the race. It doesn't matter, at least I have four or five people in front of me anyway. But the one who comes second is the one who really feels that pain the most. And that's why it's about coming first. Sariru, sabiru, you rush, you race, you run, so that no one else can catch up with you. And show you an example of these, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhu. Like Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu anhu. One day, Umar ibn Khattab, he saw the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam calling for charity, fundraising. He says, this time, I'm going to, inshallah ta'ala, win with Abu Bakr as-Siddiq. I'm going to basically give more than anybody else. So what did he do? He brought half of his wealth. Can you really afford giving half of your wealth for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? I mean, living in a city like New York where everything is crazy expensive and you have a lot of expenses and you prepare yourself for the future and so on, perhaps maybe you're close to none that would ever have someone give half of their wealth for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And alhamdulillah, there's always barakah and khayr in the Muslim ummah. So Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu anhu, he brings his money and all what he had, half of what he had, to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, saying, Ya Rasulullah, this is it, what I'm giving. And the Prophet, looking at it, says, this is really too much. He says, how much did you leave for your family? He said, equal to this, Ya Rasulullah. Which means, alhamdulillah, I split my wealth between me and the charity, the family and the charity. Then Allah made dua for, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam made dua for him. Abu Bakr as-Siddiq comes after that, and he brings all his wealth. So when Umar ibn Khattab, he said, and the Prophet asked Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, what did you leave for your family? He said, I left Allah and His Messenger. Means we have, alhamdulillah, full trust and reliance on Allah Azza wa Jal, and then His Messenger, inshallah, will help us take care of our things. Then, when Umar, he saw it, he says, Wallahi, I will never compete with Abu Bakr as-Siddiq after that. Abu Bakr as-Siddiq came first. It was very painful for Umar ibn Khattab because he could afford being above that level, but he chose maybe different level. Eventually, if you would like to come first, then you're going to have to take chances and opportunities and just put your trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala the most. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, to show you now in our sharia, in our deen, how to encourage Allah, how the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Allah is encouraging us to take these opportunities and chances to come first. He says, man khafa adlaj, whoever fears, means in this case fears Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, adlaj. Adlaj means you wake up and you walk late at night and you wake up early in the morning. For what? For ibadah, for the night prayer. And this is speaking about someone who's recently being chased out. And if you're chased out, you would like to walk in the night as much, as long as possible, basically to cover ground. And that's exactly the same concept in your life. You would like to cover as much ground as you can. But what ground are we talking about here? Time is your ground. Because that's what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to be questioning you about on the day of judgment. So you wake up at night, early or late, for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in night prayer, qiyamul layl, or salat al-fajr. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he recommends for us to compete for virtues such as what? Al-adhan and as-saff al-awwal. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam saying, لَوْ يَعْلَمُونَ مَا فِي الْأَذَانِ وَالصَّفِّ الْأَوَّلِ لَأَتَوْهُمَا وَلَاسْتَهَمُوا عَلَيْهِمَا. If they know, if they would know how much reward there is for those who call the adhan and those who pray in the first line in Salatul Jama'ah, the congregation prayer, they would draw lots to get them. Basically, you will find the brothers in the masjid fighting to call the adhan, and they will be fighting to stand up in the first line. Why? For how much reward Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is placing there. But those who come first will take that reward. Those who come first will take that reward. That doesn't mean to go and fight with your official muaddin in the masjid. But if you really want to call the adhan, you need to make an initiative and come there and be visible and ask for permission to do that. You will always come first. Next, the ulama, based on these principles of sharia, they says as one of the rules of sharia, the rules of fiqh, basically, لا يجوز الإثار في القرى. It is not permissible that you give up your the virtue of acts of worship for somebody else. For example, if the first line was completely full, and then someone you recognize comes from behind you, is it permissible for you to go backward to let that person come in? They say you shouldn't be doing that. But he's my good friend. he's so and so to me, he's this and that to me. It doesn't matter. I've seen so many brothers sometimes when there's a gap in the first line or the front line of one of them, two of them in the back, they start saying, why don't you go forward? Another say, no, you go. And this guy says, you do it, you do it. Eventually they lose the opportunity, even someone else, the third one, comes through and takes that spot. Let it be, because he came first. In that sense that he will always take that opportunity. In the subject of marriage, which you guys all love to talk about, and I remember actually giving that same presentation about love in that same hall over here, maybe perhaps a couple of years ago, I believe. Eventually, the Prophet ﷺ says, إِذَا جَاءَكُمْ مَنْ تَرْضَوْنَ دِينَهُ وَخُلُقَهُ فَزَوُّجُوهُ. And this is for the sisters and for their wali. The Prophet ﷺ says, إِذَا جَاءَكُمْ مَنْ تَرْضَوْنَ دِينَهُ وَخُلُقَهُ فَزَوُّجُوهُ. If someone comes to you, if a man comes to you, means proposing, that's the meaning of it, and you're satisfied with their deen, their level of practice of the deen, akhlaq, the other part, وَخُلُقَهُ, his character. So we have two things. His deen, his relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's the level of ibadah and worship. And the second, خُلُقَهُ, his relationship with the creation of Allah, people, his character among people and so on. If someone comes to you and you're satisfied with their deen and their akhlaq, فَزَوِّجُوا, accept their proposal. And the Prophet then says, إِلَّا تَفْعَلُوا تَكُمْ فِتْنَةٌ فِي الْأَرْضِ وَفَسَادٌ كَبِيرٌ. If you don't do that, you're going to cause a lot of mischief, a lot of fasad and fitna around the world. And that's what happens, unfortunately, because now we're not setting the criteria the right way. And the Prophet is asking the wali and women to take these chances and take these opportunities. When someone like this comes to you, and you're satisfied with their deen and their akhlaq, and alhamdulillah, their financial stable they can provide for the family, consider that proposal seriously. Don't delay it. Because if you think, inshallah, I get, inshallah, 2 or 3 years from now, I will get a better proposal perhaps. Only Allah knows what's going to happen 2 or 3 years from now. So the Prophet is encouraging us to take these opportunities and these chances. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَمَنْ يَعْمَلْ مِثْقَالَ ذَرَّةٍ خَيْرًا يَرَدْ وَمَنْ يَعْمَلْ مِثْقَالَ ذَرَّةٍ شَرًّا يَرَدْ. Whoever does a good, even if it was the way of an atom, you shall get reward for that. And if you do something evil, even if it was the way of an atom, you'll get that. So the Prophet, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, encouraging us even to seek the opportunity to earn good, even if it was just the way of an atom. Do not waste this opportunity and try always to come first. Let me show some examples on how the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhum, they used to seek these beautiful opportunities. Here's the thing. Abdullah ibn Umar al-Khattab radiallahu ta'ala. This man radiallahu anhu was a young man at the time of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. When the Prophet sallallahu alayhi passed away, when the Prophet passed away, he was around 19, 20 years old. Abdullah ibn Umar al-Khattab, around that age, perhaps. Maybe late teen, early 20s, that's around that age. However, he was very famous and well-known during his lifetime with the Prophet ﷺ to be always there and taking opportunities to benefit from the Prophet ﷺ. One of these opportunities, he one day attended the conquest of Mecca, and with the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhum, everybody gathered around Rasulullah ﷺ watching and seeing what the Prophet is doing. The Prophet ﷺ, he entered the Kaaba. And I want you now to visualize the scene. You have almost 10,000 warriors coming with Rasulullah ﷺ for the conquest of Mecca. And they're all now inside Mecca. The court around the Kaaba is full with people, all Muslims and the inhabitants of Mecca, waiting for the announcement of the Prophet, what's he going to do about them. Then here's Rasulullah ﷺ enters the Kaaba and closes the door. Abu Bakr, Rasulullah, Bilal, and few Sahaba were with him, just one or two with them. And everybody was quiet, waiting to see what Rasulullah ﷺ is doing there and what's going to say after he comes out. Suddenly, the door opens. And everybody now staring and looking this direction to see what the Prophet ﷺ is doing. He just kept quiet and he left. He went out of the Kaaba and walked out. Now everybody's going to go with the Prophet ﷺ. This young man, Abdullah ibn Umar, he immediately, to show his level of loving the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ and following his example, he grabbed Bilal Bilal was just like the bodyguard for the Prophet ﷺ, walking always with him. So he grabbed him and he said, what did the Prophet ﷺ do in the Kaaba? He wanted to be the first to implement whatever Rasulullah would do. He would be the first to do that. So he asked him, what did he do ﷺ in the Kaaba? He said, he prayed. And then he said, where? He pointed to one direction for him in the Kaaba. And Abdullah ibn Umar immediately, instantly, he moved to that spot, raising his hands, Allahu Akbar, starting making salah. Then he said, I forgot to ask him how many rak'ah. The point is that he was so actually into following the example. He wants to be the first to follow the example of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam wa radiyallahu ta'ala wa arda. He came first. He didn't want anyone to be the first person to implement what the Prophet ﷺ usually do. Abdullah ibn Abbas was also another young man with the Prophet ﷺ during his lifetime. And when the Prophet ﷺ passed away, Ibn Abbas was around the same age. Maybe a little bit younger than Abdullah ibn Umar, but around the same age. One day, the Prophet ﷺ sitting in a gathering, and there on his right side, there was Abdullah ibn Abbas, the young boy, his cousin. And on the other left side, there were the elders, another actually older man, of the senior of the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi, he received a gift, a cup of milk. And usually he used to share the milk and the food together. So when the Prophet sallallahu received the milk, he had some. And then he's supposed to share it now. Usually if you're going to be sharing anything after you serve yourself first, you give it to the person who's on the right side. And in this case, the right side, on the right side of the Prophet ﷺ, there was this young boy. And on the left side, there was a senior man. So which one should you give? Should you give it to the senior or to the boy? If you're going to follow the etiquette, you go with the right side. But if also you'd like to consider another etiquette, you go with the seniors. So the Prophet ﷺ, seeing on his right side, which is a priority in this case, a young boy, he took permission from him to give it to the senior. So he asked him, he says, Ya Ghulam, my dear boy, do you mind if I give this cup to your senior? So the boy, he said, yes, I do, Ya Rasulullah. And the Prophet ﷺ said, eventually, why is that? He goes, I'm not gonna make itar. I'm not gonna give up or pass up this opportunity drinking after you to anybody else, even with a senior. So the Prophet ﷺ says, let it be then. And he gave it to him. A young boy, you might say, but this is disrespectful. How could he do that? How could he do something like this? It's an opportunity for him to take the blessings after the Prophet sallallahu alayhi. And he took his chances. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi might not be happy with it, might dislike that, but he took his chances because he did not want to waste that opportunity, because he wanted to be the first person to take after the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. In another example, the same Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu ta'ala wa Allah, when the Prophet ﷺ passed away, he was a young boy. Now imagine now, you had the opportunity to visit Medina after the Prophet ﷺ passed away. And you did not attend, you didn't have the pleasure of seeing the Prophet ﷺ. If you go to Medina, whom you would be looking for to ask you questions? Can you tell me? You'd be looking for whom to ask your questions? Abu Bakr? The elder or the younger one? You look for the senior Sahaba, such as Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu ta'ala anhu, and those now names that we all hear about being the elders of the Sahaba, the seniors of the Sahaba. Who's going to be going to people like Ibn Abbas, Ibn Umar, when they were still 19, 18 years old? Now we know them by name, because they became very famous for us. But back then, they were just the young kids in Medina. If anybody wants to ask a question, they would go to the elders, not to these young ones. Abdullah ibn Abbas was one of those Sahaba, young ones, who made themselves busy learning and going to whom? To the seniors. So he would go and spend the day sleeping by the door of Mu'ad ibn Jabal radiallahu ta'ala. And when Mu'ad wakes up and he sees Ibn Abbas, perhaps even without seeing him, actually as he walks out of his door, and he sees the cousin of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, it's sleeping there, and the wind is sweeping the dust over him. He was surprised. He says, what are you doing, Ibn Abbas? He goes, I'm waiting for you. He says, waiting for what? Why don't you call me? I will come to you. You're the family of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He said, no. Al-ilmu yuhta wa la ya'ti. We were taught that we should come and travel to the knowledge. The knowledge should not actually travel to us. So he, radiallahu ta'ala anhu wa'adha, set that example. And when Mu'adh ibn Jabal rides his horse or his camel, Ibn Abbas would be walking with him. And Mu'adh will tell him, Ya Ibn Abbas, one of two things, whether you ride, otherwise I'm going to step down. He goes, no, you stay where you are, I stay where I am. This is how we should learn from our teacher, our ulama. So he was taking his opportunities and chances from these actually the senior Sahaba. Ibn Abbas, he had a friend. That friend, an Ansari friend of his age, his peer, he told him, Ibn Abbas, what is it you're doing? You know, going to Mu'adh ibn Jabal, Ali ibn Abi Talib, Umar ibn Khattab, and so on. Whom do you think yourself? Do you really think that the people are going to ask you any questions? He said, when I heard this statement from him, I left him. I stopped my companionship with him because he's now discouraging me. One day, that same Ansari, many generations, many actually decades later, perhaps maybe after 20 years, more or less, Ibn Abbas, he then became the senior of the community. All these senior Sahaba, they just passed away. And now the people, they're going to come and ask questions, they would go to whom? The one who had the knowledge of these senior Sahaba, like Ibn Abbas. So he saw Ibn Abbas surrounded by hundreds, if not even thousands of people around him, asking questions, and he was answering and so on. And that Ansari, who did not take that initiative, that opportunity, he just like anybody else on this block. So when he looked at Ibn Abbas, he looked at him and he says, indeed, this young boy, Hadar Ghulam, he was very clever. He was very clever because he knew what's going to happen in the future. Basically, he knew that this would become actually reality to them. People were going to come and learn from him. So you take opportunities and chances. Never listen to those who discourage you. You go and you listen, you learn, you grow in knowledge, and you grow in iman, inshaAllah, tabaraka wa ta'ala. Another example to show you this now, attitude of the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhum, of taking chances. You guys know the story of Aladdin and that magic lamp? What is it about anyway? It's basically you rub that old lamp, and the genie comes out, and the genie gives you, let's say, one wish that is granted. If you were given this opportunity, what would you wish for? I'm sure all of you probably would, maybe you would be hasty and you rush into something. Or maybe you will tell that genie, listen, come tomorrow, shall I need to think about this very seriously. That's a wish granted. Means you're going to have to think it over and over again before you give it that wish. Otherwise, if you choose the wrong one, you're going to lose it forever, this opportunity. Here's this young Sahabi. His name was Ka'b, radiallahu ta'ala, Rabi'a bin Ka'b. Rabi'a bin Ka'b al-Aslami, radiallahu anhu wa ta'ala. He was a freeman. But he was on a journey with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he took an opportunity to serve the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam for free. He wasn't asking for anything. It's just the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, subhanAllah, it's an honor to have that opportunity to serve the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So he was serving the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam throughout the entire journey. And then one day, just right when the journey was about to end, he was bringing wudu for the Prophet ﷺ, the water for the Prophet to make his wudu and purification out. When the Prophet ﷺ finished, he looked at him and he asked him, sell, which means ask for something. I want to reward you. And that's exactly the meaning of I want to grant you a wish. What would you like to have? Ask me for something. Now if you were in that position with Rasulullah ﷺ, what would you wish for? That is just like 1 billion, if not even $1 trillion opportunity. Wallah, it's not even, you can't even give it any value. Now that the Prophet ﷺ has given this young man an opportunity, you can ask whatever. He could ask, Ya Rasulullah, I want to have this camel, I want to have this house, I want to do this, I want to do that. He could ask whatever he wanted to ask for. But he has such a very high aspiration. Now an opportunity, he didn't want to pass up. He said, Ya Rasulullah, أريد مرافقتك في الجنة. I want your companionship in Al-Jannah. Which means I want to be with you in Al-Jannah. You know what does that mean if this was granted to him? What would that mean? He would be in the highest level of Al-Jannah. Al-Firdaus al-A'la, the 100th level of Al-Jannah. He would be in the companionship of not just Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the Anbiya, wa shuhada, wa salihin, wa hasuna wa laika rafiqa. He would be in the highest level of reward in Al-Jannah. But the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, looking at him, perhaps he did not see the quality that qualifies him to that level, and he didn't want to embarrass him or say, no, I can give you that to you. He told him, Awa ghayra hada. Is there anything else that I can really grant for you? It's simply, basically, I don't have that in my hand. It's not in my hand to tell you that you're going to be here or there. So can you ask me for something I can really give you? He said, Ya Rasulullah, that's what I want. Which means, whether you give me this or thank you very much, JazakAllah khair. Now Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he couldn't give a jannah to anyone. He doesn't have control of al-jannah. It's in the hand of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But he gave him an answer that helps me and you. And because of the barakah of this man, we all enjoying, alhamdulillah, the same equal opportunity to be with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in al-jannah. And what was the answer to this? He said sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to him, إِذَنْ أَعِنِّي عَلَى نَفْسِكَ بِكَثْرَةِ السُّجُودِ. Help me to assist you get there by making a lot of sujood. And that means to pray a lot. Praying a lot. How can you pray more if there are only 5 obligatory prayers? It's not about the fard salah. It's about the optional one. How much night prayer do you make? How much duha during the day do you pray? How much sunnah and nawafil do you make? That's what it counts as extra credit for you so that you will be qualified to get to that level with Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This young man, he was given this golden opportunity he didn't pass up, radiallahu anhu. And alhamdulillah, we're all getting the blessings of that answer. Another example, the mother of Anas, radiallahu ta'ala, when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam arrived in Medina, he didn't have an official servant. So Ummu Anas, she had her young boy, Anas, and he was only 10 years old. So she took him to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and she said, Ya Rasulullah, hada Anas, khadimu. This is Anas, make him your servant or messenger of Allah. Why don't you make him your servant? So, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he accepted that. Now he's a young boy, and he's now a free man, a free boy actually. How could you just enslave yourself to this? Now she knew that this would be the blessings that she didn't want to pass up back to anybody else. She took an opportunity, and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, accepted that. He accepted Anas, who served the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, for 10 years. 10 years! He was in the service of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. As a reward, the Prophet made dua to Anas, that may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put barakah in his age and his offspring. Anas was one of the 7 Sahaba who were the last to die of the generation of the companions. He survived, he passed 100 actually age almost. And they say that he buried during his lifetime, he buried more than 100 child of his own offspring, meaning his children, grandchildren and so on. Don't ask me how, perhaps they had triplets and more than that. But eventually he had buried actually so many, and that's part of the barakah that Allah subhanahu placed in this young boy, Anas radiallahu ta'ala anhu arda. Now, what we learn from this actually, that we see these companions, like Anas, Ibn Abbas, Abdullah ibn Umar, and others, they became the leaders of their community afterwards. And we've learned some qualities from them, radiallahu ta'ala anhu arda, which I would like to share with you over here. If you really would like to get to that level, if you would like to get to that level of being always first, then you have to learn these 3 things, these 3 techniques that we learn from them. And these are the qualities of the true leaders. True leaders, they share these 3 qualities. Number one, they are action takers. Means they take actions. They don't react, they act. So they always look for opportunities. They don't wait for the opportunity to come to them. They always look for these things and they go after them. And I just said at the beginning of this talk, I said there are 2 opportunities, you have 2 chances. One you've already missed, and the other one you don't want to miss. As for the one that you already have, it's no longer a chance, it's reality. So in order, if you're going to be satisfied with reality all the time, you're not going to move forward anyway. But if you truly would like to advance, then you're going to have to focus on what is next and how can I make my next step actually more profitable and more important. And also, inshallah ta'ala, in the dunya and the akhirah. So you need to take an action. Look at yourself. You're in school right now. It's time for midterm exams, right? Are you taking actions or just waiting for the exam to come to you? If you're not taking your actions, then eventually if you don't do well, don't blame anyone but yourself. Many of you come to me and they say, Sheikh, JazakAllah khair, can you help me get married? The first question I tell them, are you ready for marriage? And for them this question is just like an abstract. Because they have no idea what that does that mean, so they say, I think I am. So I say, tell me, what does it mean to you? What does it mean to be ready? I ask them, did you finish your school? They said, no. Okay, do you have a job that is stable? Well, I can, inshallah, try to work part-time, you know, with the McDonald's and then have another job after that and so on. Said, okay, mashallah. Number three, he said, do you have this, do you have that? Eventually, when they talk to me, they don't even have any clue what does it mean to be ready. Why? Because they're not taking actions. Perhaps they don't know how to take actions. But at least the point is that they're not taking the right course of action to move on forward. They're not trying to be first ahead of their game. They're just satisfied with like anyone else. Most of these guys actually come to the school and they spend, you know, 4 years and then two, three more years actually graduate school and so on, and waiting for the right time to get married. They don't try to make it. They don't try to make it. They don't try to create the opportunity by the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by taking that spouse. If you would like to have a better opportunity for life, I've been talking to many people about, you know, moving down south where it's warmer than here in New York. And many of them, they seem that they don't like to move out of their comfort zone. I said, if you don't take action, then, and you see that situation is deteriorating, it's too expensive for you over here, it's too cold for you, you don't know how to grow, you know, you cannot do much and so forth, then guess what? You're going to die like anybody else here, did nothing. But if you would like it to grow, you need to seek opportunities and take chances. And those who take the chance, the first chance, perhaps they will be always ahead of the game, instead of just waiting for people, opportunities to come their way. So number one, if you would like to take an opportunity, always remember to be an action taker. You take the action, you don't react to things. Because when you react, you're not going to be the first person to take that actually course of action after that. But if you're always ahead of the game, then inshallah ta'ala, you'll find out yourself always ahead of everybody else. That's in everything. In education, in ibadah, in marriage, in finances, in everything. Try to take the right action, inshallah ta'ala. Number two, what we learn from this. When it comes to taking actions, one thing that is very important is to learn the etiquette and the techniques of the art of making decisions. The art of making decisions. Many brothers and sisters, they think that they're ready and they have, alhamdulillah, they're taking, you know, the action and they're very proactive and they do their best and so forth. But then when things materialize before them and become actually serious, it has completely become blank because they cannot make decision. And they keep asking me, what shall I do about this issue? Can I do this? Can I do that? I used to actually in the beginning, I used to help every brother and sister with these things. But really, really, at some point, get really irritated. Why? Because now, when you tell them, okay, do this and don't do that, then they go back again, they come back and they call, okay, I did this one, how about this one? How about if I do this? How about if I do that? They can't even make decision on their own. And that's really ridiculous. If you would like to be ahead of the game and take these opportunities and chances, you need to make, you learn the techniques that will help inshallah to make the right decision. And making a decision, just like Ibn Umar did when he saw the Prophet coming out, he just immediately did not even have a second thought about it. I'll do it. And he just did it, radiallahu anhu wa Allah. And also the Sahaba, like Anas, she saw an opportunity and she went immediately. The Prophet told this young man, he said, what do you want from me? He said, I want to be companion of Jannah. Immediately made the decision on his choice. He didn't hesitate, said, okay, let me just think about it, so I'll come back to you tomorrow. He made a decision, instant decision, because that's what matters the most for him. And it helps you if you're focused and you know what you're exactly looking for to make that decision. Usually, to make the best decision, you have to use two tools. You always use these two tools actually. You use your warm heart and your cool mind. That means you rationalize the decision that you make emotionally. And you emotionalize the decision that you take rationally. You balance this, you always have the best thing to do, inshallah ta'ala. But if you just always go after, you know, emotional decision, emotional factors, then you might fail actually following the right course of action. And if you always go rational without actually following the emotion that might be involved in there, you might always be distressed or depressed after making that decision. So the best way of making that actually, that art of making decision. So you take an action and you make a decision based on that. Number three, with taking decisions, learning how to make the decisions instantly, there was always the element of taking a risk when you make that decision. There is always an element of risk. What if I did not do the right decision? Alhamdulillah, that's why when you buy things, it always comes with a 30 days return policy, right? But it doesn't work in everything in life. Like marriage, for instance. Imagine you get married and the marriage contract on the back says 30 days return policy. If you find this guy, you know, defective, you find this guy, not this and that, if you don't, not satisfied 100%, you can just bring him with that receipt and that's it. Imagine that marriage works like this. Eventually, I don't know what to say, but alhamdulillah, it doesn't work like that. So when you make the decision, it's very important. But however actually the decision you make, you need to consider the element of taking risk when you make these decisions. It's very crucial. If you don't dare take decision by taking the risk and making that decision, by taking that action for that decision, then eventually you're never gonna grow. And if you always just, you know, back off because, you know, you're just afraid that you might not get what you want and so forth, you will never achieve anything. Even if it was the wrong decision at the moment, but you have done the right course of action by taking actually a strong stance on that subject. So remember that with taking risk, there will always be a level of an anxiety. Khalid ibn Walid radiallahu anhu, for instance. Khalid ibn Walid, what did he do? When the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he brought the message of Islam to the community, Khalid was against it. For the first 13 years, Khalid was against Islam in Mecca. And then 7 years after that, he fought against the Prophet ﷺ in Badr, in Uhud, in Al-Khandaq. And in Al-Hudaybiyah, he was there preventing the Muslims from coming into Mecca. And then the 7th year, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala opened his heart for Islam for guidance. And he came to Rasulullah ﷺ and he gave his pledge. What Khalid did afterwards, he said actually that in order to compensate for the loss that he, not being of the early Sahaba to embrace, not taking the chance basically, or even take the opportunity to be first, he wanted to compensate for that loss, that being against the Prophet of all these and fighting against him, he wanted to become that warrior for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he was pursuing basically Shahada everywhere he goes, radiallahu anhu. And after many years of being in the battlefield, what happened to him? He grew old on the back of his horse and camel. And then when he died on his bed, like anybody else. He gave this statement, the very famous statement of Khalid ibn Walid. He said to the public, basically, he says, Wallahi, says, by Allah, if you look at my body, every spot in my body will have a mark or a scar of a sword, a spear, an arrow, or so forth. Which basically, I've attended so many battlefields. Basically, I was going after death. I was just going after it, but it didn't happen. And then he said, look at me right now. I'm dying on my bed, just like the camel dies. And then he said, فَلَا نَامَتْ أَعْيُ الْجُبَنَا. He said then, let the eye of the coward have no peace. Which means if you're a coward, look at me, I was going after that, didn't happen, because that is the hand of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Taking chances means taking an element of risk. So when you make actually a decision, as long as you make this educated decision, an educated, actually calculated risk, then inshallah ta'ala you'll find when taking these right chances. What happens if you don't take these chances? If you lose and miss an opportunity, you will always regret that. An example of this, Abdullah ibn Umar al-Khattab, radiallahu ta'ala anhu, wa'adda. Abdullah ibn Umar, as I said, he was always among those who always tried to be first. And following the example of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. One day, he heard the hadith that Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, he was told basically that if you attend Salatul Janazah, you will get the reward of one qirat. And the qirat is the way of the mountain of Uhud, huge mountain in Medina. You get the reward of the mountain of Uhud. And if you walk in the funeral procession until it's over, you get double that reward, two qirats. Abdullah ibn Umar, he knew about the first qirat, that if you pray Salatul Janazah, you get your qirat, that way of reward. He didn't know about the second one. So when he was told by Aisha, she said that, you know, if you follow the funeral procession, you get double the reward, double that actually qirat. He said, no, I didn't hear about that from Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He was told that it was actually true, and she said that. So he sent someone to go and confirm the news for him, and he sat in the masjid nervously. He was very nervous. You could see that he was nervous because he was playing with the pebbles with his hand, radiallahu anhu. And then when the messenger came, that envoy came to him, he says, yes, She confirmed that it is true that if you follow funeral procession, you will double the reward. What he did, he had these pebbles in his hand. He threw them on the floor aggressively, and he says, "Wallahi laqad farratna fi qararita kathira." We have wasted so many qararita. He didn't know about it, so he was just making salat al-janazah and leave it alone. And if he knew about it, he said, "I would have attended every funeral session." My point here is, I want to make actually to you, is that the life is full of opportunities. Opportunities related to dunya and related to the akhirah. And if you don't really make that decision, you don't be active, and you try to calculate the risk with making that decision, you might miss a lot of opportunities. And here is now one of these latest opportunities you have for the akhirah. The dunya, we talked about that a lot actually in terms of love and marriage and all stuff and so on. But for the akhirah, here's one simple actually message I would like to give to you inshallah ta'ala for this upcoming few days. You guys live in New York, and New York, as you see, mashallah, the weather is extremely, extremely nice these days. Very cold, so you don't get really thirsty very much. You don't get hungry very much. The day is very short. You barely start the day, and eventually after a few hours, it's already sunset. And you have, mashallah, a very long night, and still to come after this weekend, you have an extra hour for the night. So eventually you are blessed with so many things. These are opportunities now. What can you do during these opportunities? The Messenger of Allah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, mentioned that about the season of the 10 days of the Hijjah. Because if you are not aware of that, a few days from now, the end of the year, which is basically the month of the Hijjah, is starting. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says that there are 10 days of the Hijjah. 10 days of the Hijjah. مَا مِنْ عَمَلٍ. There is no good deeds that are equivalent to be done in any other part of the year more than the 10 days of the Hijjah. So you have these 10 days of the Hijjah. They said, Rasulullah, not even a jihad fi sabilillah. He said, not even a jihad fi sabilillah. The best season for the good deeds are these 10 days of the Hijjah, which perhaps is going to start inshallah ta'ala this Monday. So what are you planning to do in these 10 days of the Hijjah? What are your plans to do? I know most of you now are going to say, well, I have exams. Well, you're going to have to weigh things and make priorities. And think very well, by planning very well, being active, take action so that you shall study for your exams and also prepare for your akhirah. In these 10 days, what you can do, the day is very short. How many days are you planning to fast? The night is very long. How many nights are you planning to make Qiyamul Layl? And benefit inshallah taking some rest as well. There are so many virtues going to happen these days. Like giving Udhiyah. Making people happy during their Eid day. How much charity are you planning to give? So you need to plan that. You need to take right action for it. And you need to calculate everything so that when you give it, inshallah ta'ala, you're always ahead of your fears. Remember, when it comes to race, the worst part of it is coming second. And you don't want anyone in these 10 days to actually pass you in terms of reward, whether it's in the matters of siyam, fasting, prayers, ibarat, adkar. There are so many things that you can do in these 10 days. Of the words of dhikr, salah, siyam, qiyam, and if you can go to hajj, it would be amazing. One day in particular, that was the reward that effacing the sins of 2 years, the past and the coming one. And that is the day of Arafah, the ninth day of the Hijjah, the day right before Yawm al-Eid. You need to mark your calendars. Check it out. See what day is that going to be, inshallah ta'ala. And prepare yourself to fast, even if it was an exam day. Because wallahi, there is nothing, and nothing more than just one day for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that will be a reason for your sins to be forgiven for a past year. And even start with a surplus for the next year, bi'idhnillahi tabaraka wa ta'ala. This is my advice for you, inshallah, that you need always to try to come first and take chances and never pass up an opportunity whenever it comes to your way. Walhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. Wa sallallahu ala nabiyyina Muhammadin wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam.